Thank you, everybody. I was asked today to come and share about my faith and faith community. Thank you for allowing me to come and share my story. Many of us have had a bad experience with religion, and I'm not here to talk about religion per se. Religion to me is about acting, it's about keeping rules. I think religion is a broken human construct, much like our social, our economic, and political systems. I'm going to talk about relationships. I've just called this story Grace. In it, I hope you'll recognize something of the living, loving God that I believe in. First, let me tell you a little bit about me. I grew up out near Mabry Mill in the far southwest corner of Floyd County, Virginia. Daughter of a sawmilling dad and a praying mom, I was loved unconditionally. It's a great way to start life. Nearly 20 years ago now, I married Charlie Martin, and we have a 12-year-old daughter named Shaylee. Shaylee Grace, by the way. A few years ago, the three of us were kind of cruising along the river of life, arguing about what we were going to do, what we're going to buy, where we're going to go next weekend. My perspective was off. It was way off. I'd fallen into the trap of thinking that my life was about me, about my comfort, my security, my future plans. My perspective was way too small. In early 2007, at age 36, I learned that a small polyp that I'd had removed was cancerous. And as a precaution, I had the surrounding portion of my large intestine removed. Thankfully, I didn't need treatment, and in a matter of 3 weeks, I was back to my busy life. But applying the word cancer to your life is so scary, as many of you all know. After that experience, I was back to busy life, but I also was wide-eyed with appreciation and determined to live large every day. After that experience, we all aspired higher. Shaylee wanted to make more friends. Charlie wanted to set out with a backpack on a survival trek. I gave up my wish for a laptop computer and prayed instead for a family project that we could do to help other people somehow and to share our faith in God, the God that held us and warmed us and loved us. The following year, in the spring of 2008, we got terrifying news. My cancer was back and bigger than before. I was standing in our high school auditorium at a piano recital when I got the call. And I walked over to the little alcove just in time to hear the doctor say that it was outside the colon walls and into the lymph nodes, could be on its way anywhere. I heard him say something about it would be hard to win and to pace myself because the next year of surgery and treatment would be more a marathon than a sprint. Enjoy life every chance you get, he said. I felt the heavy crush of his words on me. The hardest thing I've ever had to do was to try to tell Shaylee, who was 7 at the time, what was going on. She'd just recently gotten interested in C.S. Lewis, the writer. And when we got to church that Sunday, when she didn't know yet, but Charlie and I did, we walked into church only to find out that in her Sunday school class, there was a guest speaker on C.S. Lewis. It was my assurance that I not only must trust God with our lives, but I could trust him. When it was finally time, a short time later, I told her what was going on, that the cancer was back, it would be harder to remove. I told her we would pray about it. She said, God doesn't always answer prayers, because she had learned in the C.S. Lewis talk that C.S. Lewis had lost his mom to cancer when he was a young boy. I said, no, God doesn't always answer our prayers on this side of heaven. I went through 7 weeks of targeted chemo and radiation, followed by 2 colon surgeries. I struggled to eat the whole time. Then they found the cancer had spread to my liver. My left lung began to collapse. Thankfully, the lung problem wasn't cancer, and they were able to remove that portion of my liver. I still struggled to eat, and we moved in to live with my mom so that she could help take care of me. I'd always thought of myself as independent, you know, take care of myself, don't really need other people. But I learned that we all need other people. I got my nutrition from an IV, from a backpack that I couldn't lift. When I had to walk more than a few steps, I used the walker that had belonged to my 96-year-old grandmother. Only with the help of a great physical therapist, I was able to regain the ability to walk right again and to control bodily functions. Thankfully, by Christmas that year, we moved back home. Then in January 2009, I started systemic chemo. That's to try to kill any remaining cancer cells in the body. But as you probably know, most chemo agents are indiscriminate killers. They take good cells with bad. So during the course of that treatment, I lost much of the feeling on the left side of my body, but we were just elated that I didn't land back in the hospital. In July 2009, my CT scan showed no sign of tumors. It was like a beautiful breath of fresh air after being in a dark, smothering cave for over a year. Less than 20% of people with stage 4 colorectal cancers that live for 5 years. So I sought a clinical trial to increase my odds. I went back to work for the first time in a year, but within a month I landed back in the hospital with an intestinal blockage, and I thought, oh no, but thankfully that wasn't cancer. Next, I began a clinical trial at Duke. They siphoned off millions of my white blood cells, injected those with vaccinia virus, and injected me with those, and also fowlpox for 3 months, hoping to help identify any cancer cells in my body and incite my own immune system to attack. I completed the clinical trial in December 2009. After 21 straight months of treatments and surgeries, I've now had 39 months with neither. I do CT scans and colonoscopies every 6 months. Just last month, my CT scan showed a spot on my left lung. They told me to prepare for surgery, but more about that a little later. Some might ask, why has all this happened? Why did you get cancer at age 36 and again at age 38? I don't know the why. I looked to the physical world for the why. Was it something I did, something I didn't do, something around me, something in the environment, some mysterious combination? If it was something I did, I want to know so that I can tell others not to do it. I would first tell Shaylee so she might live to accomplish dreams I might not, learning to swim, playing the piano, and writing a book. In reality, It's good to ask what next in a physical sense, this step in front of the next, that bite of food. But in reality, I find this world really hard to swallow without God's help. It was more like, take this step, ask others to pray. I can't explain it, but there were many times and I didn't feel like I could pray for myself, but I could feel the prayers of others moving the hand of God. Is the why of me getting cancer important in a spiritual sense? Maybe. Perhaps the more important thing is perspective. Better perspective is rarely gained voluntarily. We often ask, why do bad things happen? God gave us a free will, and it's a fallen, broken world. Maybe we should ask instead, why do good things happen? My pastor David Taylor once said, in trying to understand God, we try to understand him by our concept of good. He's loving or caring or this or that. We have that backwards. We should understand good by who and what God is. God is the standard of good. My favorite word about God is grace. As a Christian, I believe God, through Jesus Christ, paid the price of our mistakes for us. We can't work off our failures. We don't deserve this gift. We haven't earned it. He offers renewed life, free for the taking, free for the asking. What would grace look like if we could see it here in this world today? Grace is today. When you've just learned you have advanced cancer, grace is when a friend leaves work early and comes and prays you through the day. When you haven't eaten a good meal for a couple of weeks, grace is having your extended family gathered around you and being able to eat for the first time in a couple of weeks. Grace is after days with nothing to drink, finally getting an ice chip on your tongue. Grace is when the doctor says you can have finally have a lollipop, and your brother goes out and brings back a whole bag of lollipops. Grace is baptism and a feeling of new life that comes in your first shower after days in a hospital bed. Grace is a laptop computer given from a mother and a brother that allow you to live beyond the four walls and the couch that contain you. When you're so down and wiped out you can't think, grace is friends bringing over a guitar and singing the old songs and hymns that transport you to another time and help you find that rhythm inside again. In the first clinches of a major recession, grace is friends in a community given generously to cover mounting bills. Grace is a mother who knows how to pray and puts her children above herself, no matter their ages. Grace is a church family bringing communion to you in the hospital when you've been unable to attend church for months. Grace is hundreds of people reading your life and email updates and praying earnestly and fervently for you. Grace is a church you've never been a member of, providing your family's Christmas gifts. Grace is reading, "The Lord is my shepherd," and knowing that it's true. Grace is an extra piano given from a church to a child, learning to use her talent for God's glory. Grace is coworkers donating their sick leave days and an employer holding your job in uncharted and perilous times. Grace is opening cards and letters written to you, including one from a Pulitzer Prize-winning author named Annie Dillard. After dozens of visits to the doctor, grace is when your oncologist expresses concern about osteoporosis. Then last month, after an ominous threat on your lung, you're in the hospital awaiting surgery. In fact, you're in the CT machine being scanned so that they can place the precision instruments to get the right spot, and looking up to see the surgeon beaming a big, beautiful smile saying, "The spot is dissipating. Get up. You don't need surgery." Grace is meeting the donor who went through rigorous procedures at donating her white blood cells so that others might have a better shot at living. Grace is knowing the carpenter who carried his own cross and shed his own blood so that we all might have a chance to live in eternity with him and each other. Once received, grace changes your mental trajectory. Once received, grace changes your eternal path. Once received, grace changes your perspective. Jesus said in John 14, "My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid." Peace. Max Lucado said that real peace is being content if God gave you nothing more than he already has. From the time of that first beautiful garden, Fred, we've lived without staying in the borders. We've pushed beyond what we can and should do. We've failed in our strivings and relationships. Our tendency to selfishness, materialism, and blunder are enormous, but small in comparison to God's capacity to love. His tendency is to forgiveness, to grace. I believe he took on human form in the body of Jesus, who alone was perfect and perfectly selfless, to bridge the gap between God and us. How much does he love us? He stretched out his arms and said this much and died for us. Peace and contentment are not found by ladder climbing, by medication or meditation, by pathway or program. Eugene Peterson said, "If we want a life other than mere biology, we must deal with God." I believe peace and contentment are found in relationship, a relationship in which we simply accept the grace offered to us, a debt already paid, a mission already accomplished, a perfect match made in heaven, a holy communion and community in which we are raised in his resurrection. We are freed by his forgiveness. We're cloaked in his perfection and completed by his presence. Many forces in our society would have us believe that we deserve a good time, that happiness is the key, and that a new toy will get it for us, that we can accomplish anything we want if we just set our minds to it, that we can save ourselves. By God's grace, we can and should help each other. We can and should be good stewards of this earth and this beautiful place we're given. But I'm here to tell you, we cannot save ourselves. We are saved through God's grace. Every gram of food is a gift. Every prayer a present. Every drop of dew an endowment. Every ball game a bonus. And every breath a bequest. If I've learned one thing, it's that grace says little about the recipient and a lot about the sacrificial giver. You all in the community didn't do these great things because of anything good in me. You did it because of who you are, your love for a neighbor, a friend, a sister. God didn't offer up his son for anything particularly good in us. He did it because he loves us and longs for us to return to fellowship with him, to right relationship with him and with each other and with his creation. Perspective. I don't think God gave me cancer. God is good. God is love. But even horrific things like cancer, God can use for good. After all, because of my illness, Shaylee got to spend way more time with friends. Charlie got to keep his backpack at the ready for our frequent treks to the hospital. And while there, he got to plan that trip on the Appalachian Trail he still wants to take. And since his appraisal business had evaporated in the recession, he began studying to become a nurse as I sat in the chemo treatment room. And I'm delighted to tell you that last July, he became a registered nurse and now earns a living caring for hospital patients. Through this long family project, we have learned so much more about God's grace and have been able to share it with others. And do you know that in these 5 years, my child, who's all of 12 years old, has now learned to swim, she's written that book, and she's playing the piano. Perspective. As the saying goes, I don't know what the future holds, but I know who holds the future. I don't know how many years or even how many months I have left on this earth, nor do you. But I know with my greatest certainty where I'll spend eternity. I'll spend it in close fellowship with the God of this universe, seeing and experiencing good directly, unbroken by this, unfiltered by this broken lens of a world we live in. Someday I believe God will step in and make all things right. But until that day, in the midst of whatever crisis you're in, the Creator of this universe longs to hear from you, to speak to you and commune with you. I invite you to take that step toward God through Jesus today. He longs to grow nearer to you. And finally, my favorite verse in all the scripture from 1 Corinthians 13. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I am fully known. That's all the perspective we need. Thank you for allowing me to share my story today.